Blog Talk Radio.
People tell me every day love is gonna come my way, searching for clues. And I hope to try. I want something that's gonna last. I wanna live and forget the past. I know this change is gonna do me good. You know this change is gonna do me good. Even though it hurts me now, I know this change is do me good. When we're lost, you gotta prove and let me know. Don't hold me back now. Give me a sign. Tell me something really good. Tell your dreams, you know you should. I know this change is gonna do me good. I know this change is gonna do me good. Even though it hurts me now, I know this change is in me. If it changes in its own way, feeling better every day.
Aloha. Good evening. This is Andrew Aloha live out of Flagstaff, Arizona, with Spiritual Image Productions on Blog Talk Radio and FreeConferenceRoom.com. And now you stream, establishing and maintaining right relationships between human bodies. Tonight, we're doing Andrew Aloha live. We're talking with Julia Wetstein, and Arizona goes to zero waste in a heartbeat. And I do want to bid you guys all a happy Valentine's Day, especially to Mother Earth, particularly because of what we're talking about tonight. You know, I want to welcome you, Julia Wetstein, all the way out of Ohio. Is that correct?
Yes, I'm halfway between Cleveland and Youngstown, Ohio tonight, and we have probably a little more snow than you have in Flagstaff.
Got it. No, is it past your bedtime, or are you guys okay over there right now?
Well, we do have some winter storm advisories, so for the next 48 hours, we're expecting quite a bit of snow, and the temperatures here have been, you know, under 10 degrees Fahrenheit.
Oh, man.
Yeah, very, very brutal.
Wow. And again, if you can put your mouth next to the mic, that would be helpful. Bedware is the completely, and tonight we're going to be talking about a number of different things. But just to let you know, the company that Julia Wetstein is working with is called Bedware. It's completely compostable food packaging firm operating globally. They are a pioneer in the development and manufacture of eco-friendly catering disposables and food packaging. Our products are stylish, functional, or excuse me, their products are salaries functional, economic, and sustainable. The beds were a range of 250-plus compostable products, spans cutlery, tableware, napkin, hot and cold drink cups, and takeaway packaging. Bedware is a big picture packaging program. We're going to talk about all this. Julie will fill us in on all this. But right now, what I want to do is just give a big aloha to all of our underwriters, beginning with Mahadikini Lorray at www.mahadikini.com. Mahadikini Lorray's life has been a personal journey exploring sexuality and spirituality for over 20 years. She's a certified tantra counselor and tantra healer and a certified mind sound teacher. Mahadikini Lorray is also a graduate of Marvel and on General and Sky Dancing Tantra Facility Training Program and is a member of the American Association of Sex Educators, Counselors, and Therapists Club, as well as a charter member of the Association of Sexual Energy Professionals. She regularly attends trainings and conferences to keep current with the latest research and information on sexual education. And then we have the 90 Day Ascension Journey at www.90dayascensionjourney.com. And I just want to let you guys know this, for those of you guys that are interested. I'm going to put this up soon as pre-sale of the book, but I'm literally in the process of finishing up the book. I'm about halfway done. And so if you guys are interested in this book, I'll put it up so you can pre-buy it in advance. And so when it comes out, hopefully within the next month or so, then we'll go from there. So anyhow, when you sign up for the 90-day Ascension Journey, you will be facilitated with defining and redefining of your soul true life purpose. You will be assisted with finding out what Ascension means to you. On this journey, you will be provided with tools, techniques, and assistance to empower you to connect and reconnect with yourself, your emotions and feelings, and your mind, body, and spirit. Through a universal soul-centered process, you will be going through a lifelong transformation that will allow you to move forward with your endeavors and never look back if you dare. And finally, we do have Zakiran Shion at www.zakiran.com. Zakiran Shion teaches you how to co-create heaven on earth, how to become empowered to co-create heaven in your life, how to master the laws of attraction, make your dreams come true, and learn tips on how to focus your energy and attention in a consistent, persistent way so you can be healthy, wealthy, and happy. Ask questions, find out the secrets of the universe, find out how easy creating heaven on earth is in your life. Zakiran is an emissary of love and light, completely dedicated to the awakening of humanity to be their full master. Excuse me. Oh, sorry about that. And the co-creation of heaven on earth. If you missed any of this or you want to go back over any of this, you can go to spiritualimageproductions.com, spiritualimageproductions.com. On the right-hand side, you can sign up for the email list, so SIP's Divine email list, and keep abreast of everything that's happening with Andrew, Aloha, myself, and I, and Spiritual Image Productions. And we'll be, this year, it's going to be a much more rambunctious year than I think it has been in the last few years. But anyhow, there's an assortment of expos and conferences that we have scheduled. So if you want to keep up with that, you can just go there and keep abreast of everything that's happening. So anyhow, on the left-hand side, there's a link that says Andrew, Aloha, Live. You can click on that link. That'll take you to the page where I'm at, where that whole will have information on Julia Wetstein and the zero waste event that we embarked upon about a week and a half ago. Wherever you want to start at, Julia, if you kind of just want to give us a little bit of a background about who you are, where you grew up at, and how you got to where you're at, and then go from there. How's that?
Well, it's kind of an unusual story. I mean, I'm from Illinois, and I grew up in a farming community. My family still has a farm that's been in our family for about 120 years.
Wow.
And we grow corn, soybeans, and wheat, which are common products in Illinois. I know agriculture, depending on where you are in the United States, it can be really, really different, but that's kind of our bread basket is the corn, soybeans, and wheat. And along the way, I ended up as a student at Southern Illinois University, and I have 3 degrees from there, a finance degree, an MBA, and an economics degree. But I stayed on with the university working as an administrator, and for 11 years, I was the assistant dean of agriculture at Southern Illinois University, so I kind of stayed with my ag roots, and one of the programs that we were doing on campus when I was there is we started composting. Like most communities, we started figuring out that the landscaping waste that we were taking to the landfill really didn't need to go to the landfill. It was a natural product, an organic product that would break down and compost, decompose into compost. So on campus, that's the first thing we did is we started composting all the landscaping waste from the flower beds and the grasses and everything on campus. Not long after that, we decided we would start also composting food scraps from the dining halls where the students would eat. And that's another thing that it was not really necessary for it to go to landfill because it can break down very safely, very organically, naturally. So we started combining that landscaping waste and food scraps, and we did operate 2,000 acres of experimental farms. We had a lot of livestock there. But when you have livestock, you have to manage the animal waste as well, and that's the product that was compostable, which managed properly. So we ended up using all three of these materials to handle them, which would normally be a waste material, but combining them and using the techniques of composting started producing a good quality compost. So that, you know, I knew a little bit about that. Fast forward a few years, and I followed my husband out here to Ohio. He's a television engineer, a sports broadcaster engineer, and I left the university to follow him here, but through an association that I have, I happen to be a Rotarian, a member of Rotary International, and it's a service club. And so when I moved into this community in Ohio, I joined a service club, and I got connected with this man named Rob Burke, who was in the club with me, and his company has just taken on the license for Vegware, a new line of products, along with the other brands that he has in Burke Enterprises. And these products were all designed to be compostable, and it kind of fits very well with my background in agriculture, and I knew quite a bit about composting. And I told Mr. Burke, it was really amazing, because I remember when these type of resins and bioplastics were being developed just kind of as a science in university, just kind of laboratory research. It was just kind of gee whiz stuff. But to actually see it, you know, in a catalog, in a brochure where these inventions had turned into products that anybody could use, I just felt it was amazing. I didn't realize that somebody had finally, you know, brought these to the masses. And it wasn't just, you know, wasn't just research coming out of a university anymore. It was people could actually buy it and use it. So it was kind of a match made in heaven, and I made a pretty quick decision to come and work with Mr. Burke and help him build this brand. And I'm not in sales. I'm kind of a Pied Piper. I'm kind of involved in the movement of composting across the United States. And I love working with this. It makes me feel really good. I know that I'm doing something great for the earth. So we can talk more about how that all works, but that's my background. That's how I got connected to Vegware and why it's such a good fit for me.
Got it, and that's very interesting. Just to let you guys know, I was in Phoenix about a week and a half ago, and I was just hanging out there, and for the most part, and somehow I encountered Julia, and we started talking, and she was actually a participant or a volunteer for the waste management open that they had there about a week and a half ago. So anyhow, it's actually a big event that takes place in Phoenix every year. I don't know how long they've been doing it for, but if they had thousands and thousands, they said that somewhere on the scoop there was like 250,000 people there for that event. Is that correct, Julia?
Well, the 250,000 was just on the Saturday, and it was a massive crowd. But over the whole 4 days of the tournament, the course of the tournament, it was a total of 600,000 spectators.
Wow.
That came. Yeah, 600,000 spectators. And it is bona fide the largest zero waste event in the United States, probably in the entire world. And like you said, it is put on by Waste Management, and I've heard so much about it. It's been going on for a few years that I was thrilled when they invited me to come out and be a part of it.
Nice, nice. And so, we talked about what some of the stuff that they were going on. And Julia mentioned some of the stuff that she was doing with this company. Now, are you an employee of Vegware, or are you a consultant, or how do you get into the scope of all that?
Okay, well, I am a full-time employee of Vegware, and I carry the title consultant because I provide consulting services to our customers. For instance, we made a visit to Arizona State while we were there.
Can you talk into the mic, please? I apologize.
Okay, can you hear me a little better now?
I'm not sure if it's my phone or it's you or whatever, but just go ahead. That's fine. Go ahead.
Okay. Okay. The thing, for instance, a customer like Arizona State University, their sustainability department, and most universities now are having a staff person that's called the director of sustainability. If they set a goal that they want to reduce the amount of waste that the university is sending to landfill, part of that could be in their food service, and I would come in as their quote-unquote consultant to help them put together a program to divert more waste away from landfill and more to composting. And that waste would be food scraps, leftover food or uneaten food, as well as anything that was served on a Vegware container or plate or spoon or ball or whatever. Anything from Vegware is also compostable. It can all go together in a zero-waste system. And it helps the university become more sustainable and meet goals that they set for diversion. So that's where the title consultant. I'm not a consultant to Vegware, I'm a consultant to our Vegware customers. Now the young people over in Scotland, they have a different title for me. They call me the brand ambassador to the United States. That's really wonderful too. I am kind of a brand ambassador. And I'm a Pied Piper, and I'm a clanging gong because I just want everybody to realize that we don't have to keep filling up our landfills, and when they're full, nobody wants to put a new landfill in their backyard. Nobody wants to put a landfill in their backyard. So we have to figure out different ways of dealing with the trash and the waste that we generate, instead of just expecting it all to disappear and go into some hole in the ground. We have to change the way we do that, because we can't continue to fill up and build more landfills.
Exactly. So now, is it correct that Vegware is headquartered in Edinburgh?
Yeah, in Edinburgh, Scotland. And our founder's name is Joe Frankel. He's a brilliant young man. He started, I think, in about 2006. And he had experience at farmer's market in about 2006, where he got some food, and they gave him a spoon, and they said the spoon was made from potato, and he thought that was really amazing. But it didn't perform really well. I mean, it was kind of cool and interesting, but if you put it in hot soup, it kind of got soft and kind of dissolved a little bit.
But he
liked this idea of it being made from a plant instead of from a fossil fuel. So he started investigating that, and he started designing products with PLA. and I can tell you a little bit about what PLA is. PLA actually stands for polylactic acid, coming from lactose, which is, you know, a natural material. And PLA comes from plant sugar in most cases, and generally it comes from corn. So if you know a little bit about ethanol and how ethanol is made, we extract the sugar from the corn and we can distill it into an alcohol and then you can burn it as a fuel. So that's how you turn corn into a fuel. Well, in a similar process, you can extract the sugar from corn or from sugar cane or any other plant that has a high production of plant sugar. And you can convert that lactic acid into a resin, which is PLA. And once you have that resin, you can make, you know, almost anything imaginable out of it. You make clear cups that you can imagine drinking an ice-cold beer out of a clear cup that looks like plastic, only it's made from corn. It's kind of amazing. And people who look at a PLA cup can't even tell the difference. They think, you know, they will swear to you that it's plastic, but it's not. It has no petroleum in it whatsoever. And then anything you can imagine, a straw, a lid, a deli container, you know, a clear deli container with a lid on it. Then the PLA is, because it's designed to compost, it is a little susceptible to heat. So you use it with cold applications. But if you want, let's say, a soup spoon to go into a nice hot bowl of soup, you need to do a little bit more processing with the PLA so we can crystallize that PLA, and we call it CPLA, but it's crystallized polylactic acid, and that makes it a little bit more rigid and more heat tolerant, so when you put your spoon in hot soup, it's not going to get soft and wobbly and fall apart. The same thing with our lids for coffee cups. You can imagine going to Starbucks and they put a lid on it that you can sit through, so it needs to take the heat of hot coffee. And so our crystallized PLA high cups are suitable for that too. So everything in our line that would replace something you would be in plastic in food service is made from PLA. And that's something Joe Frankel started working with back in 2006. Now, and there's some other products too, other materials we can talk about, but he started growing his company on just a basic e-commerce model, and it grew to about $1 million in sales, and it's very, very popular in Scotland and in the UK. So at that point, he's doing so well, he took on a couple of investors, and now has grown, built the company into a global brand. He now sells Vegware in Australia, New Zealand, and of course, the UK and Europe, in South Africa, in Germany, many countries in Europe, in Dubai, and in Hong Kong. And as far as my company is concerned, we manage the brand in the United States and Canada and Mexico. So now Vegware is available here in the U.S. also. So he's doing very, very well. Last year they won Queen's Award, I think, for sustainability. And Joe's sister, Lucy, actually went to London and met the Queen, Queen of England, and won the sustainability award from her. That was quite a momentous occasion. But he's racked up lots and lots of awards for innovation and sustainability. And the brand is doing great all over the world.
Nice, nice. And that's awesome because, again, when I talked to you, I didn't understand the magnitude of what this company is doing and what it's producing. So now let me ask you this. So are you saying that when you're purchasing some of the silverware or whatever, the plasticware, you purchase them one for cold items and one for hot items? Is that what you're saying?
Right, and you know, you don't have to really understand too much about that. You just you just buy the product what you want, what you would like, and we've already designed it to perform the way you need it to perform. But a cold cup and a clear cup, you know, does need to have cold drinks. And we have hot cups for coffee that are paper, the paper card, that everything is either recycled paper content or definitely sustainably sourced paper. And most people don't realize when you drink out of a paper cup, paper is not waterproof. It has to be lined with something to make it waterproof, and you don't even realize it, but almost all of your Starbucks cup is lined with a plastic. It's very thin, but it is a plastic that makes it waterproof. So when you dispose of that cup, it has a plastic liner and it doesn't break down because the plastic doesn't. But in our case, we take that PLA, that polylactic acid resin, and we line our coffee cups with that. And then when you're finished using them, they can go into a commercial compost facility. And in 8 to 12 weeks, those cups and anything that we have in the vegetable line is gone. It breaks right back down into compost, which is, you know, like a soil, if you can imagine it. And it's gone. So, you know, a lot of times I'll be talking to school kids or high school kids, and I will have them pick up a PLA cup, and they hold it in their hand. You know, of course they think it's plastic, and it's not. And I said, now, you know, if you were going to have a soda and drink from that, you'd probably use that cup for about 15 minutes. And they shake their head, yes. You know, that's, you know, we only use it for a few minutes. And then you throw it away. And I said, if it's a plastic cup and it goes to a landfill, it's going to be there for up to 500 years and not break down. It's so durable. And if you use a PLA cup and you put it in a commercial compost facility, it's done in 12 weeks. And then I asked him the question, if you're only going to use this cup for 15 minutes, why does it need to be so durable that it'll last for 500 years? You don't need that much durability in a disposable cup. What you need is something that you can use and that it will go away, that it won't stay around forever. Now, that being said, you know, I'm, like most environmentalists, I'm a proponent of whenever it's possible for you to use a reusable cup and wash it and use it over and over again, that's great. That's the most sustainable thing you can do. That's the best thing you can do to keep from putting things in the landfill. But in some circumstances, it's just not practical to wash a cup. For instance, if you want to choose a Phoenix Open golf tournament and you have 200,000 people, you can't wash 200,000 cups. It's just not practical. So in an instance like that, where you are going to have disposable cups, excuse me, got a bit of a cough, to use something that's a little bit smarter than plastic or styrofoam is a good idea.
So I tell you what I want to do right now, Julia, is I want to go ahead and play some music, take a quick break, and then I want to go deep into what your company is all about, what they're doing, and even deeper. I want to dig even deeper, and I want to ask the questions that are going to allow us to see clearly what it is that you guys are doing step by step, and then what the outcome of all this is, and then where you guys are headed from there. So what I want to do is I want to take play a song called Karuna Mai by Mangalananda from his album Baj Abahu Ma, Kirtan of Divine Mother. So I'm going to send out love, blessings, healing, angels of light and love to all the lovers, all the mothers, all the females, all the males, all the partners out there on in the planet, in the universe. To all the kids and the animals and the plants on the planet, especially the ones in need of concern. I want to send out love, blessings, healing, angels of light and love to you, Julia, and your family, and to Vedver and their families, and their staff and personnel and their families. And to the President of the United States, his family. Anybody want to add to that, Julia?
Well, you know, special Valentine's to my wonderful husband, Mark. Just got home from Toronto today to be with me.
Oh, nice. Happy Valentine's Day there, Mark. Mark, right?
Yeah, his name is Mark.
Okay, so let's go ahead and send out love, blessings, healing, dangers of light, love to everyone else in concern and need. And we will be back. Karuna Mai by Mangalananda from his album Bob's your mom, her ten of Divine Mother.
Mananda Mari Karuna Mari 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 Aaya maa main tere dwaare Aaya maa main tere dwaare Aaya maa main tere dwaare Har ho roz bhay du ka hamare Har ho roz bhay du ka hamare Manandamayi karunamayi Manandamayi karunamayi Manandamayi karunamayi Manandamayi karunamayi Manandamayi karunamayi Oma, 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 Oma,
Manandamayi Karunamayi Manandamayi Karunamayi Manandamayi Karunamayi Manandamayi Karunamayi Manandamayi Karunamayi
And we're back. This is Andrew Aloha Live out of Flagstaff, Arizona, with Spiritual Image Productions on Block Talk Radio and FreeConferencing.com and now Ustream, establishing and maintaining right relationships through human values. And just to let you guys know, we just started airing these shows on Ustream, and if you're interested, you can go to SpiritualImageProductions.com, SpiritualImageProductions.com. On the front of the website, there's a player there, and you can click on that. And there's an arrow. Click on that, and that should bring you onto. They'll probably have some advertisers, so I'm just wait for them to be done, and then it'll start playing the show. So anyhow, tonight we're talking here with Julie Wetstein, all the way out of Ohio, and we're talking about how Arizona goes to zero waste, and again, a blessed Valentine's Day to Mother Earth and to everyone out there celebrating Valentine's Day, all the lovers and all the partners and so forth. And so, so now, I think, and welcome back, Julia. I want to ask you, let's see, first of all, the open, has your company, have you been to this open before in Phoenix prior to?
I have not been to this one before. I've heard a lot about it.
Okay, now I'm not sure why you're not coming in. I don't know, maybe it's my speaker, but you just, I guess just do the best you can and just go from there, but go ahead.
Okay.
No, that's better. Whatever you're doing.
Close to my mouth. Okay. So, we did an event in Blackfoot, Scotland in 2012. Made a film about it, which is on YouTube also. But it was only about 35,000 people, which is an amazing accomplishment to try to do a zero waste event with 35,000. And then we found out about the Phoenix Open. In the past, it's been 500,000 people. This year, it was even greater, with 600,000. But the planning that goes involved, I think that it takes to put on an event like this, it's really amazing. There's a lot that goes on behind the scenes. And a big part of it is making sure that everything that's used on the golf course to serve food is a material that we can handle, that we can either compost it. In most cases, it requires to be compostable. And if not that, if it's just a water bottle to make sure that it could be recycled, and having a system all over the golf course to collect that waste, either through a bin that was marked for compost or a bin that was marked for recycling, and handling all that waste there. And then there's a small bit, you know, there's some things that you can't recycle and you can't compost, so that small bit that was left over, the waste management company converted that waste to energy. Absolutely nothing, zero, went to the landfill. Now, when we did our event in Glasgow, Scotland, and you can find the short little video on that on YouTube, which is just search on YouTube for Gedgeware Guide to Zero Waste Events. I think what we achieved was 81% diversion, which is still really, really great. But if you do the proper planning and use the proper materials, and then you have enough staff and volunteers there to educate the public about, you know, what goes in what bin, which is really important, then it is possible. It's really not that hard. I mean, it takes a little bit of attention, and people do things a little bit differently than just saying, oh, I don't care, I'm just going to throw it in a bin, to know which bin. But it only takes a second or two, and it makes a huge difference. And most people, at the golf tournament and everywhere that we do a zero waste event, people are pretty responsive to that. They like the idea that that they're not throwing things away that's just going to fill up in the landfill, that it can either have another life through being recycled, you know, plastic that's reused or aluminum that's reused, and even better if it can be composted.
So now, and just before you go further, if you have an interest in connecting with Julia and Vegware, you can go to www.vegware, and that's vegwareus.com. vegwareus.com. And you can check them out there and connect with them there. Now, first of all, before we go further, if you can just kind of give us a rundown of what took place at the Open, just kind of give us a brief itinerary of what took place there.
Okay, well, the whole thing kicked off on Thursday, the 4th, I think it was, the 4th of February, and Waste Management hosted an executive forum on what they call the circular economy. And the circular economy means, very simply, you know, you create a product, you use it, you dispose of it, you find another use for it, another life for it, and it becomes something new again. So this is the whole life cycle or circular economy. And they brought in people from all over the United States and the world who are experts in the circular economy, in economics, in commodities, in recycling and composting. And for instance, the chief sustainability officer for all of Starbucks is there, and the chief sustainability officer for Yum Restaurant, which is all, you know, KFC, Kentucky Fried Chicken, and Pizza Hut, and Marriott Hotels, and Dow Chemicals, and BASF. I mean, there's the people at the top of this movement who are trying to figure out how to change the way that we deal with waste, you know, generated waste. And it was amazing. They had authors and science writers from the New York Times and these other leaders in the field, people from the Food Service Packaging Institute, and Dyer, who's the president of that, Keep America Beautiful, even the Boy Scouts, the sustainability director of Boy Scouts of America. Everybody was there to have a view to learn about how we can affect change and just do a much better job and move things forward, be more successful. And that was, everybody got inspired from that. And then from then, what I did was I started working with the volunteer team, because it takes a lot of people to work with. If you have 250 spectators at a golf tournament, and you want to talk to as many of them as possible about composting, and you need a lot of volunteers.
Now, just to let you people know, this was presented by the Action Indian Community, which I didn't know until I was putting together this campaign for this. But go ahead. I didn't realize that there was all these people there, and I just thought that there was these golfers there to golf and to compete with each other. But I this is a fundraiser, I'm assuming. Is that what I hear you saying then?
Yeah, it is a fundraiser, and it supports, I think it's a local organization. I think it's called the Thunderbirds. It's a charitable organization that gives grants to all kinds of worthy organizations and needy children, needy families and children. And I'm not connected to the Thunderbirds, but I met a few of these guys at the golf tournament, and they were just outstanding. I think they give millions of dollars away to the Phoenix area. So that's the major charity where the funds that we raise through the golf tournament go there. But as the whole and as the sustainability forum, the executive forum, are all about setting the bar and teaching people how we can protect the earth and and not turn everything in the world into a sewer or a landfill or garbage. So we have to protect the earth that we have, and some of the things that we've started doing in the last 15 years, we didn't realize would cause so many problems, so we have to evolve. You know, we have to relearn how to do things a little bit differently. One of my good friends from Waste Management, her name is Anita Cadia. She has this great quote, and she says, you know, you say you throw something away, but there is no away. It's right here on the planet. We're not shipping our trash to Jupiter to Mars. It's staying right here. So there is no away. We have to stop thinking that we're throwing things away just because they're out of sight, and maybe we just out of mind. It still is somewhere on this planet, and there are consequences to that. You know, we were talking a little bit ago about food scraps and keeping them out of the landfill. Well, you know, you don't want to do that because you can do something good with it. But people don't realize when you put food scraps from a restaurant or a cafeteria in a landfill, they break down what we call inorganically. That is without oxygen. And when food breaks down inorganically, it produces methane. And methane is 20 times more potent of a greenhouse gas than CO2. It's much, much worse than CO2. And CO2 is bad. But if we can do a simple thing, and, you know, I think 25% of all the volume of every landfill in the United States has been food, wasted food. It's not necessary for it to go in the landfill, and when it goes there, it causes methane. So there's just really good reasons to keep food out of the landfill. Now, some states like the state of Massachusetts and Vermont and Connecticut and some places in California have initiated, the government has got involved and initiated a food waste ban legislation. So now in the state of Massachusetts, if you are a food waste generator, which means, you know, out of the back of your restaurant or your grocery store, you produce a ton of food waste a week or more, you are prohibited now of taking that to the landfill because it's considered dangerous, you know, to produce methane.
Wow.
So, and they actually even enforce this. They will have enforcement officers at a landfill in Massachusetts, and if they see a truck come up and have a lot of food, they will trace that truck back to where those food scraps came from, and they will find that food waste generator, if it's a grocery store, or a restaurant, or a cafeteria, or a food manufacturing facility that had too much of a waste product, they will find them now. They're
wow.
that serious about being food scraps.
Well, no, I heard something like that in France, where now the government, I believe the government is fining restaurants and stores for a certain amount of, I guess, waste there, of food waste. If they have too much food waste going on, then they'll find them as well.
Right. This is for all those reasons. It takes up too much space. It breaks down anaerobically. And it's just, you know what? Most communities have found that when they start composting landscaping waste, you know, leaves and tree debris, it does make a compost, but once you start integrating the food scraps with it, the nutrients of that compost just goes off the charts. So it will start being rich in phosphorus and nitrogen and potassium and all of those things that plants love in their soil to grow. Those are natural fertilizers that come from compost that can replace chemical fertilizers, and they don't run off. You know, we hear about places like Lake Erie where chemical fertilizers have run off of agriculture fields into the lake, and you get an algae bloom in the lake, and you have all this problem with the fresh water source because of the runoff of the chemical fertilizers. Well, compost, you know, can replace chemical fertilizers because it's so rich. But it doesn't run off. It's a natural. It's not a chemical fertilizer. It's a natural fertilizer. And that's one of the things that I'm working hard with the waste management company is to promote use of compost because it's so good for the soil. It not only is rich in nutrients, it makes the soil more healthy. It makes it more porous and tillable, so it's easier to till the soil and plant seeds, and it's easier for roots of plants to grow in them because it's more porous. But it also holds water. So in places like California, where they have a lot of problems with drought and not enough water for their crops and water, you know, running off, when they integrate compost into the soil, it holds on to the water better and releases it better. So there's just so many benefits for compost. One of my friends in agriculture actually calls it compost is the penicillin for the soil. Mm-hmm. The soil is sick or it's degraded. That penicillin can bring it, or that compost can bring it back to life again. So, you know, when food scraps make compost so rich and compost is such a valuable soil amendment, why would you waste it by throwing it into the landfill, which no one can ever recover again? It's, you know, it's gone forever. So there's the negative effects, like methane, for one reason, but the positive effects are even stronger of the great uses of compost. So we're trying to kind of be the Pied Pipers of compost and have everybody in agriculture and horticulture and golf courses and vineyards and everybody who grow plants, vegetables and grasses and landscape planting, to start demanding more compost, because that's the key to any economy. You have to have a demand for the product that you're going to sell. And if there's a demand for compost, that pulls everything else along with it. That helps us divert all these food scraps, that helps us compost products like vegware, and it makes the economy work, because once those materials are turned into compost, you have someone who's going to use that compost and buy it. One of the things that we brought up in the Executive Sustainability Forum was the complications with plastic recycling and related to this economic factor. Because the price of oil globally is so low right now, virgin plastic, brand new plastic, is so cheap these days that the demand for recycled plastic has gone down. And it's so hard now to recycle plastic and have a market for that pelletized or recycled plastic because it's more expensive than brand new virgin plastic. So that hurts the recycling industry quite a bit.
So now let me ask you this. So it takes a number. It takes a number of weeks in pre-planning to do this whole function with this the Phoenix Open. And
yes.
Once you get there, the station set up. I mean, how does all this work? How does all this process through?
Okay, well, the educational part is the most fun, and that's what I got to do a lot. We had these three, we call them zero waste stations, and what they actually are, they're old repurposed roll-off dumpsters, you know, like big construction dumpsters. Well, Waste Management took three of them and kind of coat, you know, a window counter in them and painted them up, and so that's the station that we worked inside. So basically we were standing inside a dumpster for three or four days, which was a lot of fun, but they were all cleaned up and painted, but it kind of drove home that, you know, that's where your trash goes, is in a big dumpster. But it was set up as an educational center, so we had a lot of material there. We asked people questions and took surveys, but we also had a game, and the game was really great. It's a big wheel, kind of like a Wheel of Fortune. And I encourage people to come up, spin the wheel to win a prize. And the wheel would spin, and it would land on a disposable item. So let's see, for instance, it would land on a picture of a fork, knife, and a spoon of utensils. And so then I'd ask them the question, okay, would you put, when you're done using these utensils, you put them in with the recycling or in with the compost? And so I, you know, ask somebody that question. And then I tell them, well, you know, it's kind of a trick question because these are not normal pork sized spoons. Here at the Phoenix Open, we use a very special bioplastic, PLA, and it's made from corn. And so it can go with the food scrap. So I'd ask them, now, if your fork can go with the food scrap, would you put it in with compost or would you put it in with recycling? And for the most part, people would get compost. And then we have a button. And if you push the button and it was right, it would sing. And if it was wrong, it would have a loud buzzer. So it was a lot of fun. And we just had literally hundreds and hundreds of people come up, you know, spin the wheel and talk to Mr. Fixes. And it was all amazing. Kids loved to do it. Senior citizens loved to do it. Even on Saturday, you know, the millennials who had kind of been having a little bit too much fun partying all day, they would even come up and do it. And we just had a great time. It was a fun way to educate them about the event and to tell them, you know, that the zero waste that is generated out of this is going to go to landfill and tell them how and why. And then we also had some little computer tablets where they could go on and they could take the pledge that, you know, they were pledging that wherever it was possible, they would recycle and recycle correctly and do their part to, you know, to save the earth and to keep as much out of landfill as possible. But it was a great time. We had three of those stations all around the golf course and then hundreds and hundreds of bins for composting and for recycling. All of the vendors, though, you know, before they were brought onto the golf course, they were given the regulations. If they were going to have a clear cup, it had to be a compostable cup. You know, if they were going to use anything to go with food, needed to go to composting, and anything like an aluminum can or a plastic water bottle needed to be recyclable. And so we tried to control what was coming into the golf course before anybody even used any food, you know, even before it came waste. We managed what materials were coming in to begin with. So that takes a lot of planning and a lot of work with every.
So a big part of that was you guys educating people about how your system works and operates, and you had. And you had all these you had some stations there, but you also had these what do you call them, all over the place, where they can bend or whatever, where they can dispose of their stuff all over the place?
Yeah, and the bins were, you know, really special because they had an icon, a picture of what can go in them, and they were clearly marked, you know, what's compost and what's recycling. But there were no regular trash bins anywhere on the golf course.
Okay.
Just generic trash bins anywhere. None whatsoever. Now, what happens after the fact is a lot of that, or all of the waste goes through waste management, and the majority of it gets hand-sorted just in case the wrong thing went into the wrong bin.
And oh, really? So, even after that, you guys manually refine all that and
work through it.
Got it. Interesting.
So that, you know, that takes time and effort too, but you know, the more that we educate people, the better we'll get at that, you know. But one thing that we do with the Vegware Company that is a program for grade school kids called the Wind Detective, and it's really cute, you know, the kids get to learn about, you know, looking in a bin and use we have fun with a little magnifying glass if you're a detective or, you know, a sleuth. But they, you know, we teach them, you know, what goes into what bin, and they can look at the bin and see if something is wrong and correct it. And then at the end of the whole process, they get a sticker that they have become an official bin detective, and that's great. I mean, we start with kids. And I think in some places in the United States, we're much better than others. When you're just used to seeing a recycling container and you know what you're supposed to put in that, and compost is new to a lot of people, but, you know, we're all going to start learning, you know, what goes in the compost bin too, and it's not that hard. You just got to give, you know, 30 seconds of your attention to do the right thing. But I remember when I was a kid, we had these great public services announcements in the national campaign called Pitch In. And it's when people were doing too much littering, you know, throwing too many things on the ground. And so we started this movement of, you know, pick up your, there'll be a litter bug. And they had a little kid's character called Woody Owl, and he would say, give a hoot, don't pollute. And we had some really great, everybody remembers this iconic public service announcement where somebody was throwing a bag of trash into a stream, and they cut to an American Indian, I'm sure the actor was very famous who did this, but he didn't say anything. All you just saw was a tear rolling down his
chest. I think I remember that commercial.
Yeah.
It was a long time ago.
It's so powerful. And to my generation, we said, well, I don't want to do that. I don't want to throw my trash into the stream. I don't want to throw it on the ground. So we started changing our behavior and putting things where it belonged in the trash. Well, you know, we can do that now. We're learning a little bit more about trash and how it can be recycled or how it can be reused. And we can evolve, and we can learn how to do that. We can learn to not throw things on the ground. We can learn to put things in the right bin.
So you educate these people. You put the bins out there for people to dispose of their items in whatever bin. And then you literally manually refine that, and you separate all that into compost stuff and then to recyclable stuff. And then what happens after that? Where does all that stuff go? What happens from there?
Okay, in the Phoenix area, waste management worked with a partner that ran a commercial composting facility, and I did know the name because it was in our training documents, but it was a commercial composter. In many places in the United States, waste management runs their own commercial compost facility. And what happens with that is in most cases in the United States, a commercial compost facility is either run by a municipality or by a landscaping company because they want the compost. So, you know, they will start doing the composting themselves. Or it'll be a farm-based compost facility. So a good example of that is my good friend Nate Andre outside of Toledo. He's a large-scale farmer. He probably has 5,000 acres in production. But he set aside 10 acres of his farm, and he receives trucks that come to his farm and tip and dump landscaping waste, food scraps, disposables like mine that are compostable. And his method, and it's generally the method used mostly in the United States, are windrows. And what a windrow is, if you can imagine, is just a long berm of soil, or actually compostable material. And so it's kind of a pile, but it's a very long pile. And every few weeks, that pile needs to be turned. So he'll either use machinery like a front-end loader, or there's actually specific machinery called windrow turners that will actually kind of mix all the material in that windrow together as it starts to decompose. And the internal temperature of a windrow like that will get to 150, sometimes 160 degrees. It gets very, very hot. And it's just a natural process. They don't use any energy or fuel to get that kind of temperature. It's just the microbes and the process of decomposition gets really hot inside the windrow. And that's actually what makes the PLA break down. The heat softens the bioplastics, the PLA, and they can start breaking right back down into compost again. And what the compost will look like is initially it'll get really dark, very black, very loamy, so it'll, you know, break up easily in your hands. But in a period of about 12 weeks, and after it's been turned a couple of times, it becomes a material that can just be integrated right into the soil. And unless you really, really knew the difference, it almost looks like soil in your hands because it's broken down.
Wow.
There's a couple of management processes. You kind of have to make sure there's enough moisture on it. You have to make sure that you turn it. But other than that, it's really just Mother Nature. Composting is a decomposition process that just happens naturally. And I joke with people, you know, metaphorically, if you say, you know, God created the earth in 6 days, and on the seventh day he rested. Well, I always say, well, on the eighth day he made compost. Everything after a tree shed its leaves and the leaves fell to the ground, they started composting. So on the eighth day, God created compost before he created anything else. And that compost and that natural process is, you know, how plants and animals die, decompose, and become nutrition and, you know, nourishment for the next thing that's going to grow in that place. And so what we talk about, the circular economy today, is really the most natural economy in the world. If there weren't any human beings here on Earth, there was just plants would, you know, shed their leaves and die, they would decompose, and whatever less of them is what a new plant is going to grow out of. So that's a complete life cycle. That's a circular economy, if you want to say that.
Yeah.
So that's what happens to all the compostable waste that came from the golf tournament would go to a facility like this where it's managed in a farm-based type process. And I know that there's an organization, I think, called Keep Phoenix Beautiful, and they have some city gardens, and they're doing composting there. So if someone in your area, you know, really wanted to know more or find out what does compost look like and what does it do, that would be a great place to go and check that out.
So now you're saying that all that waste was managed by localized businesses there, not necessarily Vedua. Vedua was just there to help oversee the production of it all.
Yeah, I was just a volunteer and an engineer to try to explain to people that what do we mean by zero waste of this? Because a lot of people will come in and say, okay, this is zero waste of this, but we're generating a lot of trash. So how can we say it's a zero waste of this? Well, we would explain it is zero waste because zero of the waste is going to landfill, and we're finding other purposes for it. And I'm not involved with the recycling side, but I'm sure that the plastic water bottles would be compressed and baled and taken to a facility where they're pelletized back into plastic resin again. And the same thing with the aluminum cans or aluminum process. They'd be compressed and baled and taken to a facility where they're reconstituted into new aluminum products. So, we've been doing that in the United States for a long, long time. That's not new. But I think this whole idea of composting post-consumer products, you know, forks and knives and cups, that's really pretty new to a lot of people. They've never seen that happen before. So it does take a lot of education, and I talked to hundreds of people at the golf tournament to tell them, you know, this cup that you're drinking your beer out of is going to get composted. It's not plastic. It's made from corn. It's made from a plant. And that's, you know, that takes a lot of education.
So now you're also saying that all the vendors, the food vendors, were required to purchase cups and utensils that were biodegradable and not necessarily plastic. And was it from Vedua or just some company that had biodegradable utensils and cups and so forth?
Yeah, there are about four or five of us that kind of make similar products. So, and I looked around and, you know, all of us had different products there, and that's fine. I mean, it is a competitive environment, but, you know, we all have the same goal. My competitors that make products like mine, we all really want to divert waste from landfills. So it's a friendly competition, but, yeah, they were all there. So nobody was allowed to use a plastic cup. Or none of the food vendors could use a plastic cup or plastic cutlery or anything like that.
They were, interesting.
Yeah, that was a restriction placed upon them so that the event would work the way.
So now, and so you guys had a booth there, I'm assuming, or I guess three stations, I'm not sure, but and then you also sold some of your utensils and cups there as well, I'm assuming, as well.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't sell to the public, but those are the type of materials that were used with the food service.
Exactly.
So my role there was not necessarily to sell veggware. If I was selling anything, I was just selling the idea of compost.
Educating.
Educating those citizens. And it's great to work with waste management because they're getting, you know, they're really driving a lot of this infrastructure so that people can compost. They're building more compost facilities, they're hauling more organic material, and they're really getting on board to help us evolve the way we deal with waste.
A change that's been needed for a very long time. You're absolutely correct. And that's one of the companies that's perfect for that job, that task. It really is, absolutely.
Well, you have to give a lot of credit to waste management. I mean, they run landfills, and honestly, they would make a whole lot more money if you just threw everything in a landfill. But they're making a responsible choice to try to start building the, I mean, you can't close all the landfills tomorrow because the genie is out of the bottle.
Well, but think about it. Really, would they make a lot more money if right now, in the long run, would they really make a lot more money in what they're doing? I don't think so because
I mean, you're right.
You know, in the long run,
in the future, and in the long run,
they wouldn't.
Right. Yeah. You're right. They're making the right decision. They're making a smart decision. They are a company with a bottom line, so economics are very important. They do have to make money, but they also realize that we can't keep doing things the way we have forever and ever, regardless of you know, whether it's profitable or not. They have made the decision to lead and to help. Help us change. I mean, they didn't have to do this software. They don't have to talk about zero waste at all. They manage landfills. You know, they don't have to do this. But they just it's a matter of corporate integrity and goodwill and trying to do the right thing, even though it's expensive and it's a change. You know, nobody likes to change the way they do business, but they're willing to do that because they think it's the right thing to do.
Absolutely, and I believe so too, which is one of the biggest reasons I wanted to come here and talk to our audience tonight, because I know that this is huge. This is not by far a small scale thing. It's absolutely huge in terms of the long term effects for the earth, for humanity, and for our future. I'm absolutely sure of it, that this is really huge in terms of the direction that we need to be going in. So. I appreciate that. I definitely say that. Before we go there, what are all the different types of items that VegWare sells? Utensils, cups, what else? Or is there different types of utensils or what?
Yeah, well, there's two big things that we do. We try to replace anything that's plastic in food service. And we've talked about that quite a bit, about PLA. The other thing that we do is we try to replace styrofoam, you know, because expanded polystyrene has, you know, a lot of its own environmental problems that we know about.
And styrofoam is the worst out of all the materials out there. It's the worst in terms of what it accomplishes.
Right. Well, we have lots of alternatives to styrofoam, especially to-go containers. and you know, the normal square clamshell containers you would see in if you get a burger in or a takeout from a restaurant. We have a whole line that replaces that that's made from a material called bagasse. And bagasse is actually a waste product from the sugarcane industry. So after you make sugar from the sugarcane, there is stalks and leaves and, you know, fiber left over, and we pulp that into a paper fiber. It's kind of a dense paper fiber. It is very compostable because it's completely organic, but it does a couple of things better than styrofoam. One, it breathes a little bit better. If you've ever had takeout in styrofoam clamshell, it gets all sweaty and mushy and nasty, and you know, your food isn't good. Well, in a bagasse container, your French fries stay crispier, you know, it's just much, much better for the food. But it still has the thermal qualities like styrofoam. It'll keep your food warm. But when, you know, when you're finished with that container, you don't have a styrofoam waste anymore. You have a natural paper fiber that that can break down in compost, but it actually is not bad in a landfill either. It will break down pretty well in a landfill too. So no matter what you do with your bagasse containers to dispose of them, you're in really, really good shape. They can be put in the microwave because of the paper. They don't off-gas anything. And, you know, you should never, never, never put styrofoam into a microwave. Bad idea.
Yeah.
And if you're taking food home and you want to reheat it, you know, most people will reheat things in a microwave. But in a bagasse container, it's very, very easy to do that. It's just like putting paper in there. So we replace plastic, we replace styrofoam, and everything else we have is made from recycled paper content or sustainably sourced paper content. And you had mentioned, you know, about 240 different products. The reason we have so many is because we would like to be able to help the food service go completely zero waste. You know, there's no point in having a compostable fork when you're using a plastic cup. You know, we want to get every single thing that you use with your food service that's going to go into a waste bin when it's done. We want to be able to replace it with something compostable so that all your all of your vegware go into a bin that is lined with a compostable bag, and all of it can go to a compost facility and break down. It's clean, it's simple. You know, we talked a while back about putting the right thing into the right bin. Well, when you have everything that could go into the same bin, then it's very, very simple for the public to use. So that's why we developed so many different products. You know, if you happen to be a bakery and a coffee shop, well, you need bags and boxes and things to put your pastries in. So we have those. And if you're a pizza shop, you need a pizza box. Or a pizza square, so we make those. Or if you're a salad shop and you need a box with a window in it to take salad in, you know, so that's why we've developed so many different products, is because we want to meet everybody's needs in food service so they can go zero waste and go compostable.
Now, a couple of questions. First of all, when you're saying you shouldn't heat up something in a styrofoam, are you saying because of chemicals that are produced from doing that that are toxic to your body when you eat your food and it goes into your food? Is that what I hear you saying?
Yeah. That's what the EPA tells us, that it shouldn't be heated, and that once it goes into the landfill, that it does leach chemicals that are not safe to. So, the EPA is actually, if I quote them, they have deemed extended polystyrene foam is the fifth largest source of toxic waste in the United States. So when it becomes, after it's used and becomes waste, the EPA has categorized it as toxic waste. So if you can find an alternative, there are some places in the United States that have banned polystyrene altogether.
Oh, really?
And Portland, Oregon, and San Francisco, and it said, you know, it's got to go. It's not good. And it's very, very difficult to recycle. There are very few places in the United States that will take it and recycle it. So it's almost always going into landfill and causing problems.
Now, we got about 9 minutes left, Julia, and this is time is going by fast since we started. First of all, you guys, you know, where to from here? What happens now? What's your next step? Where do you expand from here?
Okay. Well, one, we're going to continue to develop more and more products that people need for their food service so that they have an alternative to plastic and styrofoam. Two, we're going to keep working and helping to build infrastructure. And we've been working with the state of Ohio, the EPA, and the Department of Corrections in Ohio to try to create more infrastructure for composting. And the biggest obstacle that we have right now is people want to compost, and they just don't have any place to take their organic material to get it composted. So, you know, we're working everywhere we can to help people, bring people together who can get a site certified by the EPA to run a compost facility. And we're very active in that part of the industry, that part of the movement. And then most recently, working to spread the word to anybody in horticulture, agriculture, landscaping, anybody who grows anything, to start using more compost, to demand more compost. It's very good. It's good for growing plants, but it's also a whole other industry that's going to build jobs and build an economy and build a safer planet by using compost instead of chemical fertilizers. But it's a whole industry that needs to grow so that we can continue recycling our organic material into composting. If there's no demand, if nobody's using the compost, then it won't grow. This industry won't grow. So that's really important for people to start thinking about it. I mean, if you're going to plant some flowers, go to your nursery and say, do you have any compost? Can I buy some compost? I don't know that much about agriculture in Arizona. I think it's probably ranch land, and maybe the ranchers can use more compost when they're trying to grow grass to graze cattle. You know,
there are a number of organizations, not too many of them, that grow organic fruits and vegetables or whatever. And I think mostly they're in the Phoenix area, but there are a lot of farmers markets here in Flagstaff and Phoenix, several different places, and people are really, really very pro-farmers market in Arizona, period, I'm sure of it. So now, I think maybe contacting them would be one of the places to go to, and maybe all over the country. Maybe that would be a place to tap into. I don't know if you already have, but also another place that you might want to contact that might be useful would be some of the colleges that work with agriculture, like Cal Polytech University, San Luis Obispo, and other schools all over the country that might be a good place to go to. And now
that's a great idea. And matter of fact, we are just getting ready to start a project with Florida A&M University in Tallahassee to do everything to start diverting waste from their dining hall for the students and the student union, taking it to their agriculture center and composting it. And then running trials on the compost of growing different types of plants or vegetables to see how well they grow in compost, and disseminating that information from the university. And that is really a great, great idea. because our colleges in agriculture can help a lot.
Absolutely. And that would
be old knowledge about the whole
system. Yep.
Yeah.
And the other places that I can think of, and you already talked about it, is the prisons and jail systems, where they can use those utensils. And because the utensils aren't as sturdy or long lasting as plastic is, they wouldn't be able to kill each other, you know, take those plastic knives or whatever and kill each other or whatever they do with those things, and that would be safer for them in the long run anyhow. So that would be another place
right.
to step into. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, many state prisons now have really good recycling programs, and they actually get the inmates involved in environmental literacy and recycling, and in some places they're really ahead of the game. I know in Ohio, Ohio State University works in conjunction with the prison system to recycle all the waste that comes from their football stadium, 100,000-seat football stadium. And they're doing a fantastic job, but it's a great educational program that they have in the prison system, too.
So now, you're also saying, from what I hear you saying, is that you're available for consultation through your company if people want to get hold of you and help organize some kind of a zero waste, as you're calling it, with whatever party or event they're doing. You're available to help them organize that. And I don't know, you know, if you have a fee for that. I'm assuming that you do. But I guess you guys can figure that out. Is that correct?
Yeah, if they want to just contact me through the website, we do help with zero waste events. We do help a whole business go for zero waste. We had a great meeting with the Arizona State Fair at the fairgrounds because they'd like to start diverting more of their waste, so I'll be consulting with them to put a whole system together. But you can, you know, anybody can contact me, and they're also welcome to utilize any of the videos that we have on YouTube that are in the public domain that give you, you know, step by step how to do a zero waste event.
Right.
It's fun and it's easy. Yeah. So yeah, we're out there to just spread the information and to help people learn how to do this. They may have a great idea that they want to do it, but they just don't know how. And we do. We have the expertise and the knowledge and the willingness to help people get involved in diverting more and more waste and composting more.
Got it, good. Again, Julia Wetstein with VegWare at www.vegwareus.com. VegWareus.com if you want to get a hold of Julia for a consultation and other activities and so forth. So I want to thank you for stopping by and sharing this valuable information. I think you're definitely onto something huge, and people really should pay attention and get with the program and focus on the future of who we are as a human race, of where the future of our planet lies. And I think it's very important that people take action, get focused, and really work with stuff like this on a regular day-to-day basis, not just whenever basis. Again, happy Valentine's and blessed Valentine's to Mother Earth, and again to all those people on planet Earth that are celebrating Valentine's and so forth.
90
so, anything else real quick that you want to say that we're going to talk about, Gilda?
Well, I want to thank you, too, for the opportunity to get to talk to you and everybody else who logged in to this conversation. And, you know, the thought that I'd like to leave you with is the same one that Anita Cady had told me, that there is no away. Don't think that you're throwing anything away, because there is no away. And I'll say to you,
so, exactly.
Before you think you're throwing something away, think about it a little bit extra.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank all of you for being here. Have a guys Valentine's week. Be the love that you are, always have been, and always will be. Aloha.
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye. Your conference record has stopped.
And that is a wrap. Wow, thank you very much. Were you okay with that?
Yeah, that was great. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Thank you, Andrew.
Again, I'll be putting this up on YouTube tonight, and literally people can listen to this on YouTube. So far from what I've come across so far, I've been working with Eastern for about a month and a half, and so far the YouTube versions have come out pretty decent. They can't see you, but they can still hear you. They can see me, of course, but so what? But they can still hear the whole conversation pretty good. And hopefully in the future I'll be getting a digital studio so that I can bring in our guests into the picture as well, and then get a camera so that they have better audio. If you think that your company would be interested in me representing them at the Natural Products Expo in Anaheim, we can talk about that. And, or if you guys have your own people, that's fine. It's not going to hurt my feelings either way. But if you don't have anybody to go out there and represent you, I think that would be a huge event that would be very useful for you guys to tap into. It's huge. It's really huge. Last time I went, I spent one day, and I didn't even see a fourth of the event, of the fourth of the vendors that are not even close. I mean, it was just so huge. So, but if you got people out there and they want to hook up with me and I don't know, I don't have a big budget, so I'm contemplating whether I even want to go. But if I do, I may just go for one day. I'm not sure. But if I have a place to stay, then I may stay for an extra day or so. Otherwise, if something else comes up, I'll let you know. But the Sedona International Film Festival is another place that you guys can tap into. I would strongly recommend that you guys do a documentary and then get it into film festival. That would be huge. That would be a much bigger, faster way, better way to tap into a larger amount of audience. I already know that. And if you guys need some help with that, some assistance with that, you can let me know. I've done some productions. I could assist with that. Anything else? Or whatever else. You can let me know. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Happy Valentine's. I'll talk to you next time. Good luck. Aloha.
All right. Thank you, Andrew. Have a good night. Take care.
Okay.
Okay.